efficacy of products approved by the Therapeutic Goods Administration, TGA. Loretta has made great contributions to public health and the exposure of dangerous and discredited treatments that profit through offering spurious claims, spurious cures to the vulnerable and ill. A breast cancer survivor herself, Loretta has devoted her life to uncovering cancer quacks who prey on those at their most vulnerable. Would you please join with me in welcoming Loretta Marin.
Today is an anniversary for me. On the 17th of October 2003, I was admitted to the Mater Hospital for cancer surgery. That's why I picked this topic. But here I am 12 years later, still trying to think about cancer in a different way. The real story to me started actually 2 years after my treatment. Cancer patients will do anything they can to get better. So I decided to join my local support group. And one night they invited a naturopath. And I was appalled by what she had to say. This particular evening we had a record crowd with the group. Women were sitting on the edges of their chairs. Some of them were bald, some had tubes attached to them. They all listened to everything she had to say. Well, she started off by virtually blaming us for our condition. She said that because we didn't eat organic food, because we used margarine, because we had an occasional drink, because we had dairy, this was the reason why we got cancer. She attacked doctors, saying they were owned by the drug company. She even said that they knew nothing about nutrition. Of course, she was an expert and tried to sell us stuff. Now, I challenged her on this. And she said, well, I won't get cancer, but if I do, I'll cure it myself. Now, I went home the next day and I rang up Breast Cancer Network Australia to be told by this very sympathetic woman, Loretta, she said, every day cancer patients are being given very bad advice and there's nothing we can do about it. And I thought, well, somebody should do about it, should do something about it. And 10 years later, here I am still talking. Now, I believe you've got some jelly beans down there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very passionate about getting good information to cancer, to people about major illnesses. If I go over time, you can throw them at me.
There won't be any left.
So where do you get that advice from? They estimate there's about 10,000 naturopaths, 700 homeopaths. Now, we know that they're fairly evidence-free. More recently, there's a group of integrative medicine practitioners, doctors who offer the best of both conventional and complementary therapies. A lot of woo going on there. And of course, we've got traditional Chinese medicine practitioners and chiropractors as well targeting them. Lots of very dodgy journalism going on and critical thinking. Books, of course. Now, I mention magazines here because it's not just the ones you get around at your local news agent or a supermarket. Sometimes legitimate magazines are targeted. National Seniors Association is an excellent group that protect older folk. They have a magazine called 50-something. When I opened one up, it was a third of complementary medicines, some of which were soybean and pumpkin seed for bladder control. They also were selling a book on how to cure prostate cancer. Now, I contacted the magazine several times, and in the end, to their credit, they actually removed a lot of the advertising and the book. I'm not talking about breast cancer support network here for support groups. We're talking about groups that are deliberately set up. When you scratch the surface, they're actually selling some sort of product or unproven remedy to treat patients. Websites, plenty of Dr. Google, but not offering good information. Cancer Tutor and Natural Cancer Treatment are out there with heaps of poor information. Well, since I started my work, social media has absolutely exploded. And now we're finding young cancer patients turning up, being diagnosed, waiting 2 or 3 years till the cancer spread, or coming back too late and they're dying. Now, you probably know lots of people yourself, because anybody can go to the local shopping centre, rent a shop, hang out your shingle, and start diagnosing and treating patients. There's no effective way of stopping them. Every one of these people listed here had potentially treatable cancers. Steve Jobs, there's lots of stories on the internet about them, but Steve Jobs went off alternative. He went on to juices and veggies. He went to spiritualists, he did acupuncture, and he pretty well tried everything on the internet. He regretted it before he died, but by then I had friends saying, well, Steve Jobs is doing it, it must be right, he can afford all the best advice in the world. The saddest thing, story I've read is the inquest into Penelope Dingle. This woman had a rectal tumour. Now, when you read through the inquest, you see how the homeopath it was telling her to put olive oil down her rectum and to shove velvet soap to try to help her. Also, she was in shocking pain and they said, it's in your head, you can fix it in your head. The story went on. She was married to a university professor, Peter Dingle. We should have known better. I understand that he and the homeopath were going to write a book on homeopathy for curing cancer. I'm going to talk a bit more about Jess and Sharon Ainscough. They're Queensland celebrities in the wrong sense of the word. But I think, you know, in reality, would these four people have lived? Well, I can tell you when I got cancer 12 years ago, they said I had a 95% chance of surviving 5 years. So 20 people, women, I guess, cancer the same time as me. One of them is dead, probably more now. But I'm still alive and I'm grateful for it. And I say here, some of you may have friends who've gone that way. We certainly have. And they paid the ultimate price. Terrified is hardly the right word. Being fronting up to the Mater Hospital to know you're going under general anaesthetic is not much fun. I was fortunate I was a private patient because I could pick my doctor, my surgeon and my oncologist, and it gave me a sense of control. And I can assure you I had the most holistic treatment you can think of. These people were totally wonderful. It's like the naturopaths that hate the doctors, hate science. And of course we know all the conspiracy theories. You know, the Raiders of the Lost Ark, that big, you know, the covenant in the timber crate, right next to it with all the cures for cancer. They give me a break. Doctors get cancer, their wives, their children get cancer. Why would they hide it? My own oncologist worked 90 hours a week. She would love to have more effective treatments for her patients. These people have a lot of money. Very sophisticated marketing, using beautiful people, making extraordinary claims. Some of them make money from selling the cures, and of course, if they're the patient, they don't do well, unfortunately. Now, this gorgeous man in the photo here on the right is Professor Chris O'Brien. They've just named the Lifehouse Centre after him in Sydney. I'm sure you're all aware of that. Well, towards the end, he had run out of options. And he said on 60 Minutes, I have become a big believer in alternative and complementary medicines. He went on to a strict fruit and veg diet, had electroacupuncture to energize his cells, and did a lot of meditation. You know, sadly, it didn't work. Now, I would love to talk about all of these people. They're all widely publicized, but time does not permit, so I'll just pick out a couple. Dr. Alexandra Boyd allowed her home to be used for a high pH IV treatment. 6 out of the 7 patients died within weeks. Now, these people were terminally ill, but she did hasten their demise. She was struck off the register. Ian Gawler is an interesting one because he actually did have cancer, but then he got all these lumps on his chest. They assumed it was cancer. He said, I'm going to treat it myself. He made a career out of being the man who cured himself naturally, got an OAM, he set up a meditation centre, attracted all the who's who. There was a big Barney in the MJA between his first and second wife. After he divorced the first one, she meticulously documents everything. And she said the timeline's wrong, the statements are wrong. He didn't have that food, I know, I was the cook. And we had a couple of oncologists come, Professor Ray Lowenthal and Ian Haynes, came and they had a look at the information. They had been 30 years old, but it was still there. Gawler did not have a biopsy, and they said, well, we could have been wrong. So it's all more than likely it was a TB that he had and was treated for. That was the cause of the lumps. He continues to make a lot of money out of his book, You Can Cure Cancer. Now we'll skip down. We've got dentists and tennis coaches and journalists. Jeanette Murray-Wakeland is very interesting. She's an older lady who ran a marathon a day for a year. She's the author of the book Raw Can Cure Cancer. She's raising money for a movie. What she forgets to tell people that she had breast cancer, but she had a conventional treatment for it, and she had her ovaries removed. When it comes to chemotherapy, I was told it would reduce my risk of cancer by 1%. My cutoff was 5%, so I didn't have it. Chemotherapy doesn't work for everybody, it's a percentage thing, so not sure what's going on with her, but just because she's not having chemotherapy doesn't mean she's automatically going to die. That's the way the statistics work. Lots of different types of cures, I've tried to categorise them, but they're saying is it's like fighting a fire, you need more fire trucks, so the patients get exposed to a wide range of different interventions. I counted over 20 different complementary therapies. I've highlighted a couple here. Latreille is also called vitamin B17 and apricot kernel oil. Shark cartilage, the theory behind shark cartilage was that sharks don't get cancer. Sharks do get cancer. Doesn't seem to worry the author of that book. Wheatgrass was big on the Sunshine Coast. A friend of ours was a cancer patient, was growing it, using it to treat himself of cancer and selling it to other patients. Told me he was cured, 4 months later he was dead. If the patient has an open wound, bicarb soda, black and red salve, I'll be talking a bit more about that later. Then you've got the intravenous things. You've got a couple of ranges of bleach there. That's the MMS and hydrogen peroxide. There's high pH, there's megadose, vitamin C, selenium, a whole range of things. The patients take it over a series of days or weeks. We've got ozone therapy. I heard about one guy who was putting vaginal ozone therapy for patients with illness. Pretty horrible stuff. Hypothermia. The diets, we had a session earlier on the diets. If you're quite sick, the last thing you want to do is eat raw food and vegan. I'm into the chocolate and all the good stuff I enjoy, that's for sure. The Gerson I will talk a little bit later on about. The protocols is about diet plus a whole lot of other dodgy stuff, which could be positive affirmations, supplements, goal setting, spiritualism, all that kind of stuff. And it goes over a certain time period as well. But it's been quite a few clinics. You know, I've got a sheet there of all the things you have to say every day just to make yourself feel positive. Friends of ours up in Queensland are hypnotherapists. Their group, one guy started to say to cure cancer. They left the group. We've got meditation, breast massage as a form of cure for breast cancer. We've got this really weird stuff too. And you've got your chakras are a bit damaged. Pretty tough stuff. That is whatever they are. They even did a study in America on prayer. People were praying for the cancer patient. What a waste of money, but anyway, it showed it didn't work. I'll be talking about the Rife generator in a minute. Quantum pulse, well, it's got to work, it's got quantum in it. We've got Reiki, where for $3,000 you can have your hands energized to cure a patient. Now, I have a little bit more on the photon genius. Now, if anybody can explain what this means, to re-establish the ideal irrational frequencies and harmonic energy states of each individual cell in the body, $27,400. For $3, you can use the skeptic's power balance. Same thing. Much cheaper. Feel good since I put it on half an hour ago. Yeah. Wide range of reasons for having cancer. I was told to take 12 bicarb soda pills in the morning, 12 in the afternoon, and that would stop my cancer dead in its tracks. I found one where the amalgam villains is going to cause breast cancer. Now, these toxins are usually unnamed. It's not cigarette smoking and it's not pollution. It's unnamed toxins. Then there's pathogens. We're not talking about the human papillomavirus. We all know that that can lead to cervical cancer. But there's other things like parasites, unnamed parasites. These things are very popular for causing it. And then we've got things like irradiated food, GMO, food cooked in microwaves, and so forth. All sorts of reasons why I gave myself cancer by the sounds of things. Now, I had to put this one in here because there's a skeptical link to this on the next page. Now, Helga Clark, there's a little picture of her. You can see that in the middle of the device. Wrote five books. The cure for all diseases, the cure for all cancers, the cure for all advanced cancers, the cure for HIV/AIDS, made $7 million. That little machine you can buy for $800, cheaper than half the price. The idea being, as with our power balance, that every organism has a resonant frequency. If you can just tune into that, you can kill the organism or boost it or whatever you want to do. Now, her theory was that you got a parasite, and wherever it came out of your body, that's where you got your cancer. And all you had to do was plug in the numbers into this machine, and you'll kill the parasite, cure your cancer. Well, there's a little girl there, all wired up to cure everything that ails her. Now, I'll talk to you about the big legal team. Peter Bowditch was sued by her publishing company because he didn't want to sell her books. So he published quite a blog about it on his website. He did actually sell one book in the end. Now, these people have so much money, they'll sue. Nothing you can do about it. For $15,000 a week, you could go to her clinic in Mexico and be cured there. Now, what's quite interesting is at 80, she actually died of cancer. Now, my connection to this is that I found in Christchurch, New Zealand, there was a place called the Rife Centre, Rife for Life, and they were advertising it as a cancer centre using the Rife machine. I complained 2 months later, the New Zealand advertising standards upheld the complaint and removed the advertising. Now, they would still be treating patients there. If all we can do is complain to get rid of advertising, well, we're ahead of it. Advertising works. Now, this one is an interesting situation. When you want to complain about somebody making false claims, it helps a lot to have a patient. This guy is a GP. He would talk to the patient, usually advanced cancer patients, and then refer them to the naturopath, who spent an hour with them going through all their detailed history. He claimed on his website, the parts and quotes, copy straight off his website, cheap cures. Offered a number of protocols, you see vitamin C and selenium in there. Everything was personalised to the patient. Now, when I was looking at this to complain, I actually found a letter from a high-profile referee from Northern Queensland who thanked his footy club for raising $10,000 to send him to this clinic in West Australia. And he said on the letter he had his long-term prospects are very good. We had a friend who was a fishing mate of his. And he said, oh yes, he told me he was cured. Well, of course he died within months. This is my complaint. It's quite thick. Number of pages, I've got one hand here, double-sided. I sent that in June 2009. It took until December 2014 for the complaint to be upheld, and he was fined $25,000. Now, along the way, I watched, and this resort to health actually did disappear off the website, so I knew something was happening. But 5 years? And all he was reprimanded for was behaving improperly. His patients now have to sign consent forms. I thought I'd done quite well there, until I found out that he was still misbehaving with another patient that I wasn't aware of, charged the patient $20,000, and now he's being struck off for 3 months, so he'll be back around then. So these poor patients, desperate patients, will try anything. This is 4 situations where I actually went undercover with my handmade cam. Queensland, you can actually record sound. In New South Wales, you can't. So Queensland is a very popular place for them to ask people to go undercover to expose all sorts of quackery. We've got Jill Newlands, who was doing IV to patients, terminal cancer patients, under her home in fairly disgusting conditions. The good thing about that is, got home, I was quite distressed after seeing this happening. The Health Quality Complaints Commission shut her down. Charles Angles is still practicing homeopathy. He told me not to have surgery, that he could cure me with a paste and a spray. Noel Battens is an interesting character, seems to think exercise can cure cancer, but he also sells books on natural cancer cures. Now, the weirdest guy was Reverend Trevor Robinson. He actually was happy to fly up to Queensland for an interview with the current affair. He told me that he could diagnose, he went blind, he said, click, 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 oh yes, yes, yes. Yes, you've got 70 fractured chakras. Yes, yes, yes. So I said to him, you mean you can diagnose cancer? He says, oh yes. And then he proceeded to chant to all the angels and all sorts of metaphysical beings, and he told me he was cured. And he would charge $3,000 for these treatments. We haven't heard from him since the current affair took hold of him. It's a hard way to go, going on television to expose them. I really don't find it an easy job to do, but at least I can legitimately say I've been diagnosed with cancer. But it does tend to get effect. Two beautiful women. Jess was 22 years old when she was diagnosed with a soft tissue sarcoma in 2008. Now, they did try to get rid of it with high dose chemo in her arm. That didn't work, so they said, you're going to have to take your arm off with the shoulder. Well, she said, no, I'm going natural. So she set up a website called The Wellness. Oh, she became The Wellness Warrior, set up a website, and went off to America to go on the Gerson, to learn how to use the Gerson protocol, which is 10 kilos of fruit and veg a day, 50 supplements, 5 coffee enemas, all day, every hour, for 18 months. She was housebound, just working, juicing foods. But she claimed she was cured. Wasn't long after her mother was diagnosed with breast cancer, followed the protocol. Mother died the end of 2013, and Jess just said, oh, it didn't work for her. She's so beautiful. Who wouldn't want to listen and look at her? YouTube's on how to administer coffee enemas, set up selling a whole lot of things, including coaching her own products. The media loved her. Cancer, people with cancer seem to be brave, they seem to be fighters. And someone as good looking as that got a lot of media coverage. She and a bunch of other ladies would go around the country, called the Self, Love and Sisterhood Tour, telling women how to change their natural philosophies into thriving businesses and encourage them not to go conventional if they had cancer. She earned 6 figures within her first year, and it doubled every year for the next 2 years. She paid back her father over $500,000, bought a beautiful home and an expensive car. 50,000 fans hit her website. 2.5 million visitors as well. Now, what happened in June last year, everything went quiet. She cancelled a number of tours. Then in December, she came back online and said that she'd opened her heart and mind to, you know, conventional, but all therapies, and found a great oncologist who was helping her before she died a few months later. Terrible loss of such a lovely girl. But how many patients did she convince along the way? Something that is tragic. Now, this one here was a bit of a bonus. I'd already finished my presentation a few months ago, and this young man came to our home, and he was sitting around having a chat, and he showed me an image of his father's neck, this great long open wound. Now, every night the mother would change the wound, clean it, put bicarb soda, put the bandage back on again. This was breaking the family up. The kids desperately wanted him to go to see a doctor, and he just refused to. Huge problems at home. And I said, well, why did they think this would work? He said, oh, we saw it in a New Zealand natural magazine where they cured a horse of cancer. Now, he also told me along the way that the naturopath had looked at the wound and said it's too big for black salve, but his mother was using it. And I thought, well, what can I do? So I went inside and I printed out all the conspiracy theories on bicarb soda. I printed out the TGA alert on red salve. I also printed out this image here and the story that went with it, which was in Australian Doctor, where a 55-year-old man was admitted to a Queensland hospital, and this is the end result of using this black salve. Now, that was my job done. I said, if his parents wanted to talk to me, fine, but I said, they're better off talking to a GP. So I haven't heard anything since, but I'm fairly sure he's not going to do anything. That's all I can do. Darryl Jones, this picture came out of the Sunshine Coast newspaper. He is not trained in anything, except that he was promoting a product called paper called kernel oil, claiming it could cure cancer. He used to send around flyers to us, I'm on the north side of Brisbane, which was Can Help. If you or your family members are affected by cancer, come to this meeting, we can help. All look wonderful, all look warm and fuzzy wuzzy, but when you realise that the guy was a charlatan and he was getting bigger and better, you just had to look at his website and he was selling the usual DVDs on natural cancer cures. And he was about to go Australia-wide. This indicates what the ACCC could do. The guy went and sat in his seminar, and he said, I sat across the table and I pleaded with him to stop. The ACCC do not want to go to the expense of suing people, but he said he wouldn't do it. So Darryl went down. Now, the thing was, I wrote to the local newspaper, and I said, look, here's the articles you've done on this guy. You've been praising him, saying what a hero is. Can you do something about this now that he's been taken down by the ACCC? And to their credit, they did. They did put an article out on it. Too much bad information goes on the Sunshine Coast. A little bit of good. ACCC, overloaded. They have to really pick their cases. Now, I've got here the TGA complaints resolution panel. They're very good. They may take 6 months, but in general, the people will remove their claims. But this is only about goods and products. So it could be complementary medicines, devices, and more recently, in pathology tests. The TGA, now I was on the phone to the TGA one day. Some of their investigators are very good, in fact, they're scientists. And I said, did you know there's a website in Canberra where a guy has a device where he's claiming he can cure childhood cancer? Well, before I could take images of it, it was gone the next day. So they can act if they need to. And I thought, well, he obviously did just phone him up. But the TGA in general, it's incredibly hard to get them to do anything. I think we found that from one of our previous speakers. I had great hopes for the Australian Health Practitioners Regulation Agency when they started, but unfortunately, the national law does not give them any control over scope of practice for the practitioners. And the practitioners are self-regulated, so it's business as usual. They haven't done anything or can't do anything to stop this happening. The Ombudsman recently took over in Queensland, I think the 1st of July last year. I had a woman contact me to say her sister-in-law had just died from breast cancer. The naturopath had been using acupuncture needles to plug in holes around the tumour and pushing in black salve. And I said, right, please contact in another month or so, we've got the Ombudsman, please contact him. If you need any help filling out the complaint, I'll help. Now, I never heard from her again. And then the whole Jess Ainscough thing came up and I thought, I'll look her up. Thank goodness she was in the telephone book. So I rang her and she said, oh yes, we put the complaint in. And she said the naturopath has been denying it. But the sister-in-law was way up North Queensland, but the patient's son attended the session. So the Ombudsman has been doing a lot of work, flying a lot of places to interview people. That's still going. So it does cost a lot of money to take on any of these cases. Fair Trading once told me to talk to the practitioner. That doesn't work. I'm not going to do that. Or they refer you somewhere else. Now, the New South Wales HCCC has improved, but still not strong enough, and the others, nothing they can do. Now, the bottom line with TGA listings is it's virtually impossible to get any goods taken off the TGA. A lot of these devices are listed with them. They've been accepted as sometimes biofeedback devices, some other name. How can we change this? Complain. The only way you'll ever get a service challenged is if you manage to get the bleeding patient onto the steps of Parliament House, half dead. Because unless they have a patient who's been severely damaged, there's no winnable court case, no action. Another thing, how can we change this as well? Complaints. Now, some of you here may be reluctant to write complaints, so there is option B. Our group is Friends of Science and Medicine. Our aim is to foster good science and medicine. And there's the saying, no battle was ever won by spectators. So I'm inviting you all to join us. Now, the only requirement is that you stand by our principles and commitments. You can look at our website. We're getting a new one soon. But that one's still there. You can find me there. There's my email address. We've got Twitter and Facebook. Join us as followers. Followers on both. We'd love to have you on board. So thank you very much for listening to me. Thank you.